our players who have fought really against get to this spot.
They're both really strong players.
Oh my goodness. What a game.
We are ready to get this match underway. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Gen Con 2015. I'm Will Shick, Director of Business Development. I'm here with Ed Bourelle, our Creative Director, and we are here to bring you the Iron Gauntlet Finals for the qualifier match here at Gen Con 2015. This qualifier match will lead on the way to the World Championship, which will happen at Lock and Load 2016 next year. And what a match we have for you today. We have two very unique armies. We have a returning face, Jason Watt.
That's right.
Who piloted the Convergence to the finals match for the World's Finals, which he lost, unfortunately, against Jay Larson in an extremely close game.
Second place.
Words.
Yep, there you go. He is bringing Father Lucan, Divinity Architect, with a whole host of Clockwork Vessels to take advantage of Lucan's special abilities against the first time, I believe, that we've ever seen a Retribution army
Yes. Hit
the finals match of any qualifier.
We've got Vyros and Sisar of the Dawn Guard, mm-hmm. Run by Daniel Porter.
Yep. So we've got what looks to be a very exciting match. Of course, both armies beautifully painted. Daniel's Retribution are just gorgeous. He went with the Studio White scheme and did an excellent job with it.
Yes,
of course, Jason Watt's Convergence also looks fantastic with the color scheme that he chose on those. Our scenario today will be Recon, one that we just recently saw in the finals match for Lock and Load at the World Championships for 2014-2015 season. In Recon, there is no kill box. You can control a zone for 1 CP, you can dominate a zone for 2 CPs, or you can dominate a flag for 1 CP, and you can destroy the enemy objective, which of course contests the zone, so you have to destroy before you can start controlling or dominating the zone. For 1 CP once per game. First person to 5 CPs or to a Warcaster or Warlock Assassination wins the game. So our players are going to be forced to decide whether they want to divide up to each flag or if they want to go hard and heavy for that middle zone. Of course, with the army list that we're looking at here, I think we should see a pretty ugly scrum across the middle of the table.
Absolutely.
Things he set up there. You know, in terms of matchup, we've got Jason Watt, who's got Father Lucan again. He has the corollary. He has 3 inverters and a Prime Axiom, so a heavy-hitting battle group there for Father Lucan, something that can take punishment. Shield Guard from Father Lucan, obviously going to be used to good effect here for Jason to protect his key pieces. We've also got 2 Enigma Foundries for the recursion aspects from their ability to collect souls from the soul vessels that are destroyed, return them to the table. 3 units of Clockwork Angels, which pose a rapid-moving, difficult-to-handle threat. Of course, they're a little fragile, being small unit size and only 1 wound, but they can be a scalpel in the hands of the proper player, which I'm sure Jason is. In addition, we've got a full unit of Obstructors, full unit of Reciprocators, just adding to that armor wall that Lucan wants to bring to the table, and 2 Optifex Directives for their repair abilities and their ability to reconfigure their vector weapons to be magical. Not going to be a huge issue in this game, but the repair is definitely going to come into play for sure.
Over on the Rhett side with Daniel Porter, with Vyros' battle group, Vyros and Sisar of the Dawn Guard, he's got a pretty typically massive battle group. So we've got Imperatus paired up with 2 Aspices. He's got 7 Griffins in there, yeah. So there's going to be just a lot of advancing, decent armor for a light mm-hmm. Myrmidon.
Griffins are amazing.
And then Reach, and then he's also got a Banshee in there, and those mm-hmm. are going to pair up great with Synergy, mm-hmm. Along with potentially Easy Rider. Like, he's got a lot of, those 2 control area spells mm-hmm. that mm-hmm. he can choose from easily, and paired up with Bird's Eye, mm-hmm. he's going to be able to fly right through forests mm-hmm. if he uses Easy Rider, wrong Warcaster. and then he's got 2 Arcanists in there to keep those Warjacks as mm-hmm. efficient as possible. Narn, Mage Hunter of Iros on top of that, and Lanissa Rissel, Nis mm-hmm. Sorceress. So mm-hmm. he's got a minion in there to dish out Hunter's Mark mm-hmm. or some Ice Bolts and Winter Storm. Mm-hmm. After that, she's got Fane Knight Scarith Issian mm-hmm. and 2 units of Stormfall Archers to rain yeah. down some ranged attacks.
I mean, at the end of the day, this is just a terrifying Vyros list between the Griffin speed and the synergy bonus that he's going to very easily be able to take off, combined with Hunter's Mark. I'm not going to be surprised to see one of Jason or to see Jason Watt's Prime Axiom just disappear in a puff of like smoke if he positions just wrong. So one of the really interesting things I think about this game, talking to the players, talking to the judges, is that what we're looking at here is very much a game of maneuver. You've got a really good matchup in terms of, you know, Jason Watt's army is hard to crack. It's got high armor, it's got a lot of repair, it's got a lot of recursion for its troops, and it's going up against this Donlard virus list, that the Instancer virus list that just obliterates whatever it touches between synergy, the Arcanist's ability to boost strength. He's got two really hard hitting jacks between Imperatus and the Banshee. So, you know, the real question is who's going to position wrong? Who's going to put their units in an inappropriate and a wrong spot and suffer for it, because each player has just the right tools to handle what the other person's bringing.
Right.
So it's going to be a very exciting match. You can see Mr. Watt lining up his troops, second place Jason, as he's apparently become known. He's now doing his advanced deploy with the Angels, finishing up deployment here. Just a ton of jacks on the table, and one of the funner matches I think we've seen because of that. It's just you've got two very different lists that really rely on their battle group to get the work done.
Right.
So the clock is underway. Daniel now doing his advanced deployment with Narn, checking the distance there really quick. And you see our players shaking hands as we are ready to get this game underway. So we see Jason Watt allocating one, going to make use of the Convergence's ability to transfer that focus across their induction nodes. Along with the corollary, Jason's going to be able to build up to a pretty impressive turn in terms of focus efficiency. One of the things that definitely allows Convergence players to run much heavier on Warjacks with no loss of support. Jason getting some quick updates on Vyros and some of the other models' defense and armor stats, along with their speed. He's definitely trying to play conservatively with the Angels, although dashing them forward using their speed 7 and flight to jump into that that trench that runs across the middle of the table. Of course, he's got to be careful of the Griffin's fleet and Hunter Mark, which between the two will give them 4 extra inches on a charge, along with Pathfinder, Reach. Just an impressive threat range on those things.
Whatever Daniel decides they need to get the job done.
Pretty much. Hitting with Hunter's Mark, Clockwork Angels in a trench is going to be pretty difficult. But still, Fleet is more than enough to get them there with the Reach. See Corollary, activate, advance up, take its focus point, drop it off to the Prime Axiom. Prime Axiom drops a Servitor from its launch bays. And the Prime Axiom then runs. Zipping forward there. And it was an Entombment Servitor that was dropped. So we've got some flare action, which will help Jason out quite considerably in terms of hitting. See an Inverter run. Drops its focus to nowhere, so no induction there with that focus. See the Entombment Servitor running forward, getting in position to drop that flare next turn. Have the next Inverter running forward, going to induct that focus point into the other Inverter, I'm sure. We'll see that happen. We see Lucan going, doing 3 for Deceleration and 3 for Watcher. Watcher, an interesting choice at the start here. Basically going to throw it up for 3 now so he can upkeep it cheaply later. And Lucan being more of a midline caster, wanting to get close. Watcher allows him to be careful about getting attacked from an alternate vector. So we see Pathfinder getting thrown on by the Optifex Directive. And then running forward right through that rough terrain forest there, using the Pathfinder. And we see the Reciprocators running forward and declaring set defense for their variable weapon. That mostly just an aggressive turn here from Jason, one that you typically would expect. We see the Obstructors going now, running forward. Not worrying about the shield wall, just trying to get it in a better position. You see a couple of the models converging together, as Jason says, tangling up with each other. An issue quickly solved. The Enigma Foundries, I'm a little interested in terms of his deployment with the Enigma Foundries, keeping them so close to the obstructors rather than trying to spread them out with the reciprocators as well. So expect to see him just try to make that obstructor unit a total pain in the neck for Daniel.
And Jason passes the turn over to Daniel. Pretty quick turn, but there's a lot of models to move. Daniel's going to run into the same conditions.
And the biggest thing that Daniel's going to have to overcome here is focus efficiency. Unlike Jason, who can use his induction abilities and the corollary to really fuel up his massive battle group, here you've got to pick and choose with the Griffins. You kind of have to have a first wave, a second wave. See some quick defense checking on those Angels. Daniel really wanted to do some early work here. Of course, anything that goes after those Angels is going to get really pummeled in the face by inverters next turn.
It will hurt. Curious to see. I assume there's going to be a couple of sacrificial models in there.
I mean, when you've got seven Griffins, you can lose a couple. I mean, you don't want to throw them away needlessly, but...
No, but...
So we see two going on Griffins. And two focus.
To the Aspices.
Mm-hmm. Which I think was one each to the Aspices. It doesn't make a lot of sense to me as to why he would drop two on each.
Correct. His words were, two focus to the Aspices. I think that's what that means.
So he almost put it on. I almost put those focus on the Imperatus and the Banshee, but chose not to at the end. So looks like he's going to be leading off with those light Myrmidons.
So we've got some
Stormfall.
That was Lanissa Rissel, I believe.
Mm.
Yep, she's going to Hunter's Mark. She's going to try it.
It's a tough shot. So good distance.
And that's not going to do it.
No. Nope. Between the trench and the Angels, respectable defense of 14. You're looking at 18s there, needing 11s on two dice.
So we're getting a power booster on the Griffin from an Arcanist activation.
Yep. These Arcanists are so critical to this list working.
Yep.
Between the strength boost and the additional focus they can lay out. That will be the Angels' primary target, I'm sure, on Jason's next turn. Some consideration there going on.
So we've got a Griffin running up on Daniel's right flank. Puts his toe in the woods. And
getting in front of Lanissa there to try to protect her from those Angels. Lanissa being another kind of cornerstone piece to this list with that Hunter's Mark.
And another power booster on a Griffin,
mm-hmm.
who I have a feeling is going to run up and close that gap.
Yep. We're just going to see a wall of Griffins for this first turn here. Oh, not getting base to base. Of course, he's got a lot of jacks to go.
But still, you make a wall of Griffins, nobody's flying over them.
There we go. He came back.
That's what I was expecting.
Binomial, I mean... Arcanist defense isn't great in terms of everything. Being Death 13 is average, so the Clockwork Angels being only Rat 5, lacking the CRA ability that they get under Aurora, definitely makes them more difficult to shoot, but on average, three of them shooting it is going to get rid of one Arcanist. And Daniel's only got two.
All right, we've got Stormfall Archers advancing on the right flank. That trench is really nice for those Angels right now.
Mm-hmm. Yep, being immune to blast damage from being in the trench really offsets.
Yep, he is going to go ahead and take some snipe shots.
Going to be short.
I'm going to check the deviation. Maybe it stays in the trench. The Clockwork Angels don't have the best armor at 12, so if it can land in the trench, it could still potentially do some damage.
See another range check there. Needs boxcars to hit. Not good. Deviation. 1 to the 6 inches. Catches nothing again. Some subpar deviation rolls at this point. Boxcars again. Nope. Deviation goes 1 inch to the 5. So they're going to check really quick.
Yeah. Yep. It is inside the trench.
All right. And so 14 decel saves them. Arm 12 being buffed up by Lucan's deceleration spell, which gives them +2 defense and +2 arm. And then we see the last shot scattering out of the trench and doing nothing.
Yeah. Needing boxcars every time to hit. Those deviations just didn't come up for him. And when they did, he needed 9 to kill.
Yeah.
And didn't quite get it.
The trench making those angels far tougher than they normally are against blast damage. Oh, Vyros takes a spill.
Vyros down.
Gets the boxcars finally and nails a Clockwork Angel. So POW 12 with that roll should be no problem there. Checking his Enigma Foundry range. And the Enigma Foundry is in range, it looks like, so he will get a soul from the Clockwork Angel.
And they're going to see if the blast damage is going to reach that other angel.
Let's see a quick remeasurement.
Nope. No blast damage.
Mm-hmm. See another shot, hoping for another boxcars here. Nope.
That's he's chewing up a good bit of his clock looking for boxcars that result in deviations. It doesn't seem like a lot at the early in the round or early in the game, but toward the end, it catches up with you really fast.
Yeah. I mean, at this point, with D-Cell up needing nines, I mean, those Stormfall Archers are also endangered from the Clockwork Angels. Those angels really represent a credible threat to Daniel's entire army. They're not going to hurt the Jacks, but the Jacks need those support pieces.
Right.
And the Stormfall Archers certainly can get some work done if they can stay alive. So, you know, prioritizing them at this point with their forward position as well. The time might come back to bite him later, but I think...
Bite him in the what, Will?
Bite him in the butt. It's clearly the word I was going to say, Ed.
Absolutely.
It's a family show. See that Griffin running forward? The one that was power boosted by the Arcanist. Getting up there, towing in the zone. That's, That's a really aggressive move when you've got a Prime Axiom with Dreg that's right within a range at that point. I mean, you're kind of baiting the Prime Axiom at this point, but it could be at the cost of 2 Griffins. And while the list has 7, you want all 7. See the last Griffin running or advancing forward. It's creating a kind of conga line of Griffins there. Paradis advancing 6 forward. I mean, the follow-up is Paradis. If you can get him in with good synergy bonus from the lights, he can pretty much one round anything he wants.
Yep.
See Vyros advancing 8 inches. Daniel making sure that the scenario is not kill box, which of course it is not. Now he just has the Fae Knight left to activate. Decide where that guy's gonna go. He's gonna try to hold up those reciprocators. He's gonna reposition for somewhere else. A little surprised that Daniel.
So Narn's charging an angel over there on the right flank.
So we see a quick measurement from the judges.
They're stopping time.
It's only got 10 inches, so I think that's going to be well out. So he gets to go right to there. See him fall short. Narn misjudging the distance. Yeah. By about an inch and a half. See Scareth Issian going. He's going to run. Now taking his precise measurements through the forest since he does not have Pathfinder. It's 12 and a half left through the forest. Go. So kind of just repositioning Issian to be on the flank over there, protecting the Stormfall archers.
Well, and if that the angel doesn't go too far, he's not going to fall short on that charge.
No. See the So Daniel finishes his activation and passes the turn back to Jason. I'm a little surprised that Daniel didn't drop his feet last turn. With no real warrior models to speak of and definitely casualties happening this turn, he could have utilized that potentially to good effect to try to minimize the damage that Jason would be able to do against his griffins this turn. And potentially some of his Stormfall or Arcanus. So Jason considering where he's going to allocate focus. Lucan upkeeps Watcher and sits on 6 at the moment. Jason checking defense on the Arcanus, which is, of course, a 13. He's going to be looking for those angels to get rid of those support pieces as quickly as possible. Interesting.
They have charged.
Charged a griffin. I mean, brutal charge only brings them up to a pow plus strength 12 on their binomial blades. It's going to be not great damage against that griffin. And he's kind of cut himself off from the drag. He's got the reform. That would lead to a lot of free strikes, though, so I don't see that happening.
He does put 10 damage out on that griffin with the first hit.
It's impressive. It's the Michael Plummer School of War Machine. Roll well. Roll high. We see them reforming out after doing their damage. Trying to reform to stay within 2 inches of the griffin.
And we had a...
And we see the judges quickly checking stuff here. So because Bird's Eye allows Daniel's battle group to ignore intervening models, Watt can't trust on having the griffins themselves block line of sight and therefore free strikes to other models. Which creates kind of an interesting minefield effect when you're trying to stay within one model's melee range and not really thinking, because normally you wouldn't have to. So we have a quick clarification that the angel is moving to face forward, but is not positioned exactly like that because of models interference of their models. So the second unit of Clockwork Angels is advancing forward. I'm expecting that these guys will take some shots at some Stormfall archers. Try to thin out the herd there a little bit. See Daniel helping Jason out by marking the spot where he declares his movement to. First binomial being shot. Gonna need eights to hit. First one misses. Second pair is going to do a CRA. It's a CMA that Aurora grants them. So this will bring them up to a seven. Get that power 12 kill. So one guy down. Reform into the trench as best he can. With D-cell in the trench's benefit, as we saw, being very effective against the Stormfall's AoE attacks. Jason now looking at the field. We see the reciprocators now charging, and they choosing set defense with their variable melee weapon. Of course, not needing the extra POW at this point, but rather needing to set themselves up to take the charge that may come from Scareth Issian, who, if Narn drops to this, is going to activate his...
Boxcars will definitely hit Narn.
Righteous Vengeance. So Righteous Vengeance, or Righteous Fury, excuse me, is activated. So Issian will have plus two strength and arm for one round, along with his weapon master ability, makes him pretty terrifying overall. Rapid strike and blast. See a charge from the other angels. Flag goes flying. So four damage to the two on the damaged griffin already. See the clock paused.
One of our judges, Mr. Travis Marg, replacing the flag there while the clock is stopped.
Jason taking a little bit of fun jibing for his violent dice rolling.
All right, next time on Dice Gone Wild.
Apparently now his new nickname from second place Jason is now Wild Dice Watt. So a bevy of different choices. Three damage to the six from the second angel's charge.
Griffin's still in good shape, though. He's got all of his systems.
So you see Watt having to really think about are those rear griffins close enough to take free strikes because of Bird's Eye. Substructor's running forward into the trench. Obstructors obstructing, doing what they do. So I'm curious as to what Jason's plan is with the Prime Axiom at this point, because he's certainly cut off any drag opportunity between the Angels and now the Obstructors. With the tow cables being range 11 and speed 5.
He might just be aiming to take out the objective at this point.
It's possible. The Spiker, the Excella Spiker's range 13, POW 11, six shots, although he didn't allocate any focus. So we see the corollary gain its free focus from being within Lucant. See power transfer. Here comes three under the Prime Axiom, I'm going to assume. If he's going for that objective. Nope. So... power transfers one to an inverter and induces one to the Prime Axiom. Prime Axiom activates, creates an attunement servitor, spends its focus to run. Doesn't look like he needs a run. Nope. He just advances. Spends his focus to run, so he can just get the induction. I mean, from this angle, it looks like he could have taken some shots, although not against those griffins in melee. With Lucan's Rat 3,
right.
Not super impressive. See an inverter activate run, induce its focus into the other inverter, which, of course, advances or spends and runs. Making the best out of that speed 4. Lucan's sitting on a whole lot of focus right now. It's the Optifex Directive, running forward. Second Optifex Directive unit runs forward base to base with the Prime Axiom. Ignite Founder getting up so it can collect some more souls. Inverter runs, gives its focus back to the corollary. Her induction. Another Enigma Foundry runs forward. In a position to do souls. Lucan activates next. Watt now considering what he wants to do with Lucan. Lucan advancing 3 inches forward, checking his control, which is 2 inches higher thanks to the corollary. So 5 inches just to get within the zone. It looks like he's just going to camp on that focus. Lucan feet. Very. So, Lucan's feet now up, making his army extremely durable with +4 arm. The repair abilities, which allows repair skill checks to automatically succeed, won't come into play here. So, Lucan's outside of the corollary's ability to extend his control range now after his movement. So he's 14 inches. So even with the loss of the repeater range from the corollary being outside of its 5 inches, everything within Watt's army is easily within his 14-inch control range. So it's all +4 arm at this point.
That's going to make those vectors and angels, well, The vector's particularly tough to crack, mm-hmm. but the angels with the high defense and then a mid-level of armor.
Mm-hmm. Well, and if he got a couple of those inverters within 2 inches, he can use Shield Guard from Lucan on those inverters to really just mess with those AoEs that managed to hit.
Right.
So, of course, Jason apologizing because he had measured 16 inches when he advanced Lucan forward without checking repeater range, and of course it turned out he was slightly outside of repeater range.
Well, mistakes do happen in these kind of games. But the players are understanding that, mm-hmm. you know.
These guys have been playing for 2 days now, high-pressure event. In addition, they've also been playing in Masters and other things. I mean, the frenzy of conventions and everything else. Part of it, like we always talk about, is an endurance game. Just being able to come to the table and stay mentally sharp despite being tired and hungry and everything else that goes on. And it's the mark of a great player who can do that.
Daniel's kind of eyeing up the battlefield, asking a few questions. Under Lucan's feet, his options become much mm-hmm. more limited.
Yeah, I mean, he has the ability to rack up a pretty high synergy bonus at this point with all of his stuff. One of the interesting facts about our players is that Daniel Porter is actually, these guys both come from each corner of Indiana. So we've got one from the southeast and one from the northwest, or southwest and one from the northeast. Or is that reversed? Either way, Indy bisects right in the middle, so our judges were having a pretty fun time talking about this coming together of these two Indiana boys representing for their half of the state right here in the middle. See some amount of focus allocation going on here. Those, of course, one of the issues that Daniel's going to have to deal with is that he's got to clear those Clockwork Angels out to get some good charge targets to those inverters or the Prime Axiom. The synergy, of course, upkept by Dawnlord Vyros, or Intercessor Vyros. Still a Dawnlord. also an Intercessor. Jason.
Watt's in a good mood today.
Watt is in a good mood today. That little hand flap was him demonstrating what he believes the Angels look like.
When they fly.
When they fly. So Virus is going to sit on two.
That left flank group of Stormfall Archers is going to activate up mm-hmm. behind some cover, hopefully in range to benefit from that should the Angels or decide to mm-hmm. make some attacks.
The deceleration isn't up this turn, so...
Slightly more possible
slightly
to hit.
Slightly more possible to hit. Still basically boxcars, though. So he chooses to pick the direct hit causing continuous fire. And he's firing at the obstructors. So it does hit. Quick check with those blast keys to see which models are affected by the fire. Just the one.
Got fireproof flags here in the Iron Kingdoms. Mm-hmm.
Well, you can run right through them, too. So, you know, they're basically ghost flags. So there's a shield guard. You see a quick move so that Watt can get a better angle on checking the AoE blast. So the inverter goes on fire. Inverter taking the arrow for his obstructor friend.
I think we're going to see some more fire.
My expectation on this one would be... I mean, the fire is definitely the right choice here because Brutal isn't going to net you much against Reciprocators with plus four arm. You might as well take the POW 12 that happens after the feed expires.
Right.
So you see the first fire shot. Does right. hit.
You've got plenty of targets outside the trench over there as well.
Mm-hmm. So, second shot misses. Third one does hit. One of those elves needs to go back to archery school. They're just giant walking robots, man. Just hit them. Hit them. So one of the things is like at this point you kind of have to expect that Daniel's either going to try for these two inverters here because overall I don't think that he's going to be able to clear out this line and this line and still have enough attacks to actually make a difference on the Prime Axiom. Taking the Prime Axiom out first is obviously would be a huge win, but two inverters down is still also something that would be well worth it at this point in
with
the game.
With that plus four armor, though, I'm not even sure that both of them are reachable.
No, it depends. If he can get Imperatus and a Banshee in with a high enough synergy bonus, which he should be able to do with the Griffins, they might be able to crack through with some decent rolling. Now, he's obviously going to focus on one and then move to the other, but, you know, inverter sitting at 32 boxes, arm 23 right now. Significant.
Significant, yes.
But, again, with synergy and the number of jacks he has to mm-hmm. be able to take synergy up.
You can certainly overcome that plus four
armor. He can swing over the plus four and actually swing higher, too. The Angels' defense, though, makes it difficult. And Griffin's only at mat 6, needing 8s to hit, even with 2 attacks. And the Banshee's going to go first, so the Banshee's clearly not going to try to get any work done. Just a boost ahead of an attack on an angel. Hits with an 8. Easily destroys the angel. And synergy bonus is up by 1. So that's 1 down. The Banshee, though, entire activation used to kill a single angel. It's not what I think you want out of your Banshee. So Griffin advances forward, boosts his halberd shot him, or his shield. Yeah, boosts his halberd. So trying to clear a path here, get to those inverters. Synergy will be up to 2 at this point. Watt checking for his Enigma Foundry Soul Collection abilities. Convocation. So he's opened up a path now. He's got Synergy up to 3. Up to a 2.
Up to a 2, yeah.
Right. Up to a 2. Shield attack missed the other angel. Still got a lot of stuff in the way. I mean, you got this angel here you got to get rid of. You got this angel here you got to get rid of at minimum. And then, of course, this angel who is in the way for these guys here to come flying through. So, Arcanist doing what the Arcanist does. Power boosting. So, Griffin backs up to stay within 1/2 inch of the angel.
So boosted attack hits the angel.
Yep. And that will destroy her with no point.
And there's our synergy of 3 now.
Yep. So he's got to get 1 more angel, and then he'll basically negate Lucan's feat. But he's quickly burning through models.
Is that 3 of 7 griffins?
It's 3 of 7. 3 of 7 griffins. Well, no, 2 of 7. 2 of 7 griffins and a banshee.
Banshee.
So he's got 5 griffins left. He's got 2 aspices and he's got Imperatus. And Imperatus is obviously going to be the ace in the hole here. Whatever Imperatus hits with synergy up to 7 or 8
goes away.
It's just going to disappear. But currently, I don't think Imperatus has any focus on him. Which maybe means that that's not what he's going to do. Yeah, I don't... So what's the plan here? Just kill some stuff and weather the feat? Certainly an option. Those inverters are real close. Not to mention you still have to worry about the drag from the Prime Axiom. And once you start losing Griffins, the Viros synergy trick quickly starts to degrade. So Griffin advance. He's going to swing on an angel. Now mat 9, thanks to synergy. No real boost needed. 2 attacks here. And you see a quick confirmation of the synergy bonus here. Just making sure. So mat 9, no boost. Does hit. Pows well more than enough.
Yep. Synergy 4 now.
Yep. Synergy 4 for the next one. See how that virus list just works here. So, yep. 1 Clockwork Angel unit down.
And no soul for the Enigma Foundry on that one.
All right. So, we've got a clear path, but we've got some Griffins in the way at this point. That other Griffin sitting on a focus that it didn't get to use. Every focus point in this list is so critical. You just hate to see one not get used, because that's a focus point that could have gone on a different jack with a higher synergy bonus to do some work on those inverters or really anything at this point. Griffin simply advancing.
Getting out of the way there. Clearing a shot for a couple Griffins from the back.
Yeah, trying to connect, it looks like, with a couple of angels here, one with the shield and... Yeah. So
he hits the angel behind him thanks to Bird's Eye, 360 degree front arc.
So he forgot to check his melee distance before he ended his movement, made his attack. So now it comes down to his guess, but it looks like he's good. Griffin.
Good thing they measured it before he fell over.
Griffin tips. So synergy up 4. Mits a mat 10.
That'd be synergy 5 now.
Well, this one's on 4. Yeah, but the total is 5. So the next guy will get 5.
Right.
So there goes another. There goes another angel. Synergy now up 5. So over Lucan's feet and a +1 of damage. So spends the last focus to heal the shield. Puts a point back on the shield. Judge is commenting that they don't see that very often, but it is a super sweet ability. So, Fuel Cache being Daniel's ability, obviously super useful for this list. As Fuel allows models beginning within 4 inches of it to be able to run or charge without spending a focus or being forced. We're going to see those griffins do a little bit more work thanks to it. These are the aspices here running forward, trying to get within shield guard range so that when a griffin gets pinged with a tow cable, they can take it instead. Sacrificial aspices. So we see Imperatus advancing forward. Just a huge pile jacks right in the middle there.
Ready to explode out on the next turn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just a pile of crazy. It's just a huge gap. Well, of course, a lot of dregs being cut off here. You can only dreg these guys. You've got an Aspis here, and then honestly, the Aspis here, who, if you shield guard that first, can't go forward because he gets blocked by these guys. You can pretty well mitigate the dreg threat here at this point. You see Issian just running off the table. Into the corner, hanging out. Here comes some fire rolls. So, 3 fires on the reciprocator stay. An obstructor does not suffer fire this turn as it goes out, and the inverter suffers fire as well. So first reciprocator takes 6 points of damage. Next one takes none. And the third one takes 4. So, decent rolling on the fire damage there. Inverter takes 1 point to the 4, starting in on there.
So, if Watt leaves that fuel cache alone, there's going to be a lot of free charging next turn.
Yes. Yeah, that fuel cache just, again, we talked about how focus is so important for this virus list here, in that you really need to maximize your ability to get those griffins charges. Once synergy bonus is up, you want to be able to maximize attacks on models like Imperatus or the Banshee. Overall, a very conservative turn from Daniel, just weathering Lucan's feet, getting rid of most of those Clockwork Angels, trying to remove the threat that they pose to his support models. Lucan's going to allocate 1 to an inverter, 2 to another inverter. They're going to go in and try to get some work done against those griffins. Watt clarifies that his current allocation decisions may result in 0 allocation Teacher of the Inverters. So it's a sum between 0 and 3. Carefully planning out his thing here. See him separating those focus into piles. 2 to Inverter, drops Watcher, and keeps 5 on Lucan. So Corollary is going to go first. Try to get up there and drop some more focus out. See power transfer happen. Going to fuel up one of those inverters. So inverter goes up to 3 and inducts 1 to the other. So the, both those inverters are now at 3. Convergence just being one of those factions. The only faction. Plays like hordes. Tomb Incinerator just sneaks forward. It's going to drop a flare into an Aspis. No reason not to, since it'll just shield guard it. So 12 is going to miss, or is going to hit. Excuse me. So that's going to drop pretty much everything right there. So just knock all those defenses down by a lot. Because it's all this stuff right here. It's all glowy, like the sun. All right, let's see a quick pause here for some judge clarification. A measurement of 16 inches. So, judges quickly conferring as to the measurement there. If virus is within Lucan's control area, and the determination is that he is, so now Watt has some decisions to make with his next activations. Unit of Angels activates and charges. So first one gets that damaged Griffin, trying to get it out of the way. Second one goes after a Griffin further back. Last one looks like it's going after the same damaged Griffin. Behind the objective. First attack hits no problem. Dice minus 6. See if you can get a big roll here. Not a big roll.
1 point of damage.
Second one misses. Last one in the back hits. Needs a big roll. 2 to the 6. Not incredible. So less work than what Watt was hoping for here. Wild dice Watt. Lucant goes, activates, spends 3 for purification, removes synergy, and takes away the fire that has been left on the board. Positive charge goes on the inverter on the Watt's right. Lucant then decides discretion's the better part of valor and scampers back. Scuttles? I think scuttles would be effective there.
Seems very scuttly.
Scuttle. Yeah. Four legs. I think you scuttle when you have 4 legs. Especially when you're running away.
Well, and your legs are metal sticks.
They are metal sticks, yeah. He's very spindly. Like a spider. Here comes the inverter. Charging forward. One with the one with positive charge. Induces into the prime axiom. Comes the wrecking ball. So, just some horrifying damage potential from the inverter here between its macro pummeler, which you can hit once with palpable strength 20 and knockdown, and then a meteor hammer that just annihilates everything and ignores the shield.
Yeah, the macro pummeler just hit for 15 points to the 5.
It's just huge. And it doesn't matter if the shield's down or not, because that meteor hammer doesn't care as a chain weapon.
I wouldn't want to be macro pummeled.
No, Being macro pummeled just doesn't sound like a good time. See, 8 damage to the 2 at this point from the Meteor Hammer's first initial. See a bind attack on the first Griffin. Plus 3 of that roll is not impressive, but it does wreck it. Because when you do 15 damage on your charge attack, it doesn't take much. See bind attack on the aspect, on the other Griffin, which is damaged. And 12 points thanks to the Meteor Hammer's ability to chain weapon attack and positive charge. So it was 22 on the Macro Pummeler, 19 on the Meteor Hammer. So we're checking induction to the Axiom. So see a movement on the inverter so that it can be in the proper position, although its facing needs to be clarified. See a charge against the Aspis. This inverter's just going to do a lot of work. Make sure that he's in range. He's got reach on the Meteor Hammer, but no reach on the Macro Pummeler. So he gets to within half an inch by the slimmest of margins. Macro Pummeler goes. Will get the positive charge bonus from his other inverter friend. Dice plus 6 here. 17 points to the 2. Rips through that Griffin. Chain weapon attack on the Aspis. Auto hits. Dice plus 3. That'll do.
14 points.
two swings. Dead Aspis. All right, so we see a bind attack. Has 2 attacks left. That Mat 10 will hit thanks to positive charge. Positive charge plus flare. Doing the work for him, even on a 3. 11 points to the 5. See if he can 2-shot this Griffin. Not impossible if he rolls decently well here. It's not going to do it, but that Griffin does not feel good right now. And I'm guessing those reciprocators are going to come in and finish the job. So the reciprocators go next. You've got to be variableing for strength at this point. So plus 2 power with empower. And here comes the charge. So first one charges the Griffin in the forest. No problem with its distance. Second one charges the same thing. And this one charging, going base to base. Trying to maximize as many guys as he can get in there. Watt can drop that severely damaged Griffin. That's going to be a huge net win for him in terms of dropping that synergy ability. Plus, he stripped it with purification, meaning Daniel's going to have to spend focus that he'd rather put on his jacks to put it back up next turn. So pause on the clock. Quick check on the melee distance. He is within. So quick check on the line of sight to make sure the charge is still good. It is. Model moves in, but the proxy base stands in for it. And the last reciprocator just runs forward to get in the trench. So see our attacks being made here. So first one's a 12. Hits, no problem. See those reciprocators just getting work done here. You see the reciprocators there, using empowered attack. Also benefiting, I think one of them benefiting from positive charge. Yep. So giving him plus 2 to his attack and damage rolls effectively. See a check for the redirect on the attack. Does hit. He gets positive charge, so he's POW 16. So it's just straight dice, just 3 points. Not great, but better than it could have been. Without Empower and Positive Charge. And that'll end the Reciprocators. See the Optifex Directive running forward. Getting ready to do some repair work on those inverters next turn. So the Obstructors charge next. Getting ready here to do some work as well. Just a whole lot of destruction happening in the middle of that table there.
It's quite the scrum.
It is. It's pretty much exactly what we kind of expected when we looked at this matchup in the first place. Just a huge pile of stuff in the middle of the table. See a quick check on melee distance as one of the instructors charges against the Stormfall Archers behind the wall. The rest of the obstructors just running forward, trying to do what they do, get in the way. See the leader running in the middle. So everyone else is just running at this point, knowing that they're not going to have the range to get any attacks off. Jason being very careful to try to put as much in the way of his Prime Maxim as he can. So we see one of the models staying out of formation in the back. So we see charging attacks against the objective. First one hits. Deals a decent amount of damage. Does hit. Ignores the shield on the Griffin. So 16. So 5 off. Does 9 points to the 5. So a great shot there. See a hit again. 4 to the 2 this time. So the chain weapon ability once again coming into play against those Griffins. And the guy who hit the objective gets set on fire from the fuel cache's ability. It burns. See Daniel there kind of considering his next move as he looks at the table. He's got a lot of work ahead of him at this point. Loss of 3 of his jacks definitely hurts the synergy ability. See the last inverter advance forward into the trench.
I still think Watts is probably going to lose those 2 inverters unless Daniel picks a different target.
Mm-hmm. It's going to come down to his focus. He's going to have to spend a couple for synergy to get it back up. So we see an attack against the objective, dealing 3 more. Another Cell Spiker. Hits. Dice off 7. Does nothing. Buys 3 more attacks on the objective. Hits it for 1. Oh, so these are the tow cables first. So 2 auto points. No drag, though. So buys, hits, nothing, and then 1 point. So out of all that, not a ton of damage from the Prime Axiom. 8 total, 2 of those being auto points from the tow cables. See an obstructor coming back, thanks to the Enigma Foundry. Another Enigma Foundry goes, advances, just runs. Just have that unit of Optifex Directive. You see them running. Zipping forward. Into the zone. All right. That will end Watt's turn. So pretty effective at this point. Positive charge goes away, being a turn.
What a mess.
What a mess. There you go. Ed Burrell, ladies and gentlemen.
I am still here.
So you can just, that top-down shot really just shows exactly what that scrum looks like. It's not a whole lot of armies that can lose
four
jacks in a single turn and still have a ton of jacks to play with on the next turn. So we can see that focus got allocated to Imperatus and also to the Banshee. So those two models are likely going to come in and try to leverage the synergy bonus to take out the inverters there. See, oh, no, there's no focus on. Oh, yep, concentrated power goes on, giving +2 to his melee damage rolls on Imperatus, which makes him a monster. Looks like Virus gave out all of his focus this turn, too, so he's not going to be relying on synergy to get this job done. Virus activates. He's going to advance back out of the woods.
No, that's it.
Oh, that's Arcanist.
The Arcanist.
It's the Arcanist.
Virus is on the horse.
Looked like he still has to suffer through the forest penalty.
He does have his toe in the woods.
Concentrate power I'm expecting on the Banshee here. Yep. Concentrated power goes on the Banshee. Which also makes the Banshee pretty scary, too.
I think we'll kiss those two inverters goodbye. Virus does have focus, and he is casting synergy.
And he's going to just zip into the woods and take a swing on one of those reciprocators. So Virus is going to start kicking that synergy up.
Yeah. Swing and a hit.
That one will destroy the reciprocator. Only had one damage left on him. So quick confirmation that you can check a model's melee range at any time. So quick check to see if that reciprocator is in his melee range. So, quick discussion here about which one's damaged.
Also confirming location, because we've got a proxy base in there with the model that it actually is tipped up on it a little bit.
Yep.
Brutal damage shots from the Stonefall Archers. Stormfall Archers, my apologies.
They might as well be Stonefall at this point. They haven't really been hitting much. There we go.
Dropping rocks on robots.
That sounds like a great kids' board game. So no damage there from the snipe shot. See a brutal shot again. Trying to clear out reciprocators here. Does hit. Gets rid of that proxy to reciprocator.
Right.
So checking defense on the reciprocator in the trench. So it's going to be 17. So needs a high roll here.
That'll hit.
Gets it.
Not a good damage roll.
No. So two whole points there on an impressive hit. So we see a miss. And it's going to go a whole lot of nowhere. So synergy is +1. Super Carrot is getting shot by arrows. Who saw that coming? Advanced Robotics taken down by bows.
Advanced bows.
Advanced, advanced arrows, maybe. I think the bows are pretty much the same. See Linus Arissel? Interesting. So Hunter's Mark against the Super Gator in the trench. Hits it with an 11. You see a quick arm raise from Daniel there. So that's a big roll. So we got extra distance for Skirith Issian to zip in there. Although Issian does not have his Righteous Fury up. So he's only going to be a helpless strength 13. So we got 15 here. See him going right to there. No big deal about the flag. All right. With
confirming no set defense.
Mm-hmm.
And that's so a
13 weapon master.
Handful of dice.
That'll delete that reciprocator. And we're going to see a field promote here after Watt checks to see if he can grab himself a soul, which looks like he can. So up goes a soul. And the Hunter's Mark will expire at this point since its target is dead. You'll see a shield bash. So synergy bone is still just plus one. And misses. So halberd attack at a further away obstructor. Trying to clear out the path here a little bit. Does hit. That'll bump synergy up to two. So we've got Matt 8 now on the Griffin. See a shield smack, which does connect. That'll drive synergy up to 3 for the next one. And does manage to destroy the obstructor. That got bashed with the shield. Halberd attack here. Does hit and does destroy. So
starting
Enigma Foundry starting to collect a lot of souls.
They're confirming Synergy 3.
Mm-hmm.
Things are getting heated up over there for those Myrmidons.
Mm-hmm. At this point, it's just get those Griffins out of the way so the heavy hitters can come in and do the damage.
Turn them into Murderdons.
Murderdons. I can't see that without picturing like some kind of crazed elephant. It's a little too mastodon-y. A Murderdon. Can you draw us what a Murder Don would look like?
I think it looks exactly like this.
Yeah, exactly like that. That looks like a hand to me, honestly. It's like Travis Marg hand right there. We could make Travis a Murder Don here. We'll give him some horns. Oh, he stuck his head out. There, it's back. Oh, that's unfortunate, Travis. Lean back a little bit.
You gonna give him the Michael Plummer treatment?
I am. Travis being there's his trunk. It's always hard when they don't cooperate with you because they have no idea what you're doing to them until later.
I can get up and just hold him in place there.
You
if
could.
We need to.
Just wait a minute. Stop the game. All right, so we see the Griffin finally making his first attack here. Matt 9, no problem. Oh, this is the Aspis, excuse me. So Daniel confirming he has to choose beat back first or second. He chooses not to beat back. So POW 14 now because of synergy plus 3, dice minus 2. Six points. Not enough to delete that reciprocator, but close.
Second attack.
Yep, does connect. Still dice minus two.
Murdered on.
And murdered. And he chooses to beat back to get out of the way. So just slides over a little bit. Trying to clear a path for the Banshee and Imperatus to go do the work. That Griffin, though, now with plus four to its synergy is going to be able to do some serious starting. Quick check to see if he's within range of the Meteor Hammer, which it looks like he is. So he's just going to advance. Such a way to stay within reach of both. Now that Griffin, plus four with synergy, that Griffin's going to be hitting pretty hard. Not necessarily with the shield. Shield attack hits, POW 13, because of synergy at plus four. Does nothing. It's kind of to be expected, but synergy is up to five for the next guy. Halberd attack at the same target. Plus four, should hit no problem. So he's POW plus strength 17 with synergy up. 5 points to the four, it's a good start. So on inverter one, and that'll get things kicked off for the big bots. So figuring out which Griffin is left to activate. And that's the one in the forest. He's still half in the forest here, is yet to go. So that'll bring up the synergy to plus six before the Banshee or Imperatus go. You see just an advance straight forward. Checking his melee range. So we're going to see a halberd attack on the damaged inverter. Oh, so he's going to exit. Shields. Oh, halberd. Interesting. Just trying to put some damage on both, apparently.
No, I think he's attacking the guy furthest from him with the halberd.
So okay. Shield attack first because there was no declaration. And you
definitely
choose.
Definitely not the further guy then.
No. You choose the highest on the card. So synergy's now bumped up to a six. Which makes that Banshee and Imperatus crazy high with concentrated power. So POW plus strength 18 on the halberd. 7 points to the four. Ugh. This is just what Virus does. Promotes serious inter-office synergy. So the Banshee's just gonna walk forward. Plus eight from synergy, plus two from concentrated power. He doesn't even need to roll dice at this point.
Synergy at eight or nine?
What's the point?
Or sorry, seven or eight.
It's at eight, I believe. Or seven, excuse me. It's at seven. So we're going to get 24 plus two from concentrated power, 26. Hits no problem. POW plus strength 25 currently. 15. Jeez.
That's just about half of his total damage, and he mm-hmm. already had damage on him.
Mm-hmm. So second shot with the reach weapon. Hits with nothing but ones.
Ooh.
And wrecks him.
That'll do it. That's another 15.
And that inverter is just dust. And now, Imperatus sitting with all the synergy. I mean, Imperatus could roll a bunch of snake eyes. That's about the only thing that will save that inverter. So max reach range here for Daniel and his Imperatus. Swinging at the inverter.
Oddly enough, I just noticed that Daniel is wearing one of the previous year's Ram shirts.
Yes, he is.
Featuring a Convergence model. This might be his. Let's hope that doesn't
it's
bring
true.
Him bad luck.
He is kind of working at cross purposes here. Watt kind of explaining the confused look on the directive who had Jax in front of them and now don't.
Oof. Boxcars.
Yeah, no problem there. Sets them on fire. See if that matters.
It's a, a burning wreck.
Yeah.
About to be wrecked.
It's effectively just going to be a cloud
even,
of
even
ash.
The judge said, don't bother marking it. It's, we'll wait and see if it's still there.
I'll be honest, that's probably the right choice
waste
here.
Waste the energy. Oh, Tim Bankey.
Dice plus seven here. I mean, that's...
he's you're thinking about boosting it.
Why would you boost? And he's boosting it. Why? Just because.
Oh, my gosh. It's a, that's 15 on the dice. So, 22 points of damage?
Yeah. 22 yeah. points of damage. It's not enough to one-shot it, but it's close.
That's okay. I have another big, giant flaming sword.
He does. Five boxes left after that. Now to be fair.
Everybody at the table right now is just in awe and of how incredible the damage output is. They're just laughing.
Parrot is boost to hit his second attack to not roll snake eyes. And Parrot just kills it without even rolling. Dealing seven auto points because of the synergy bonus and concentrated power. So Imperatus is going to sidestep. He's going to jet forward, it looks like. Which is interesting. Yep, ditch back. Still has plenty to worry about.
Man, imagine if he had had four more of those Myrmidons.
At that point, why roll? Don't even bother. Just destroy things outright without even rolling dice. So we see these Stormfall archers advancing forward over the wall, start swinging at things with their swords. Daniel even checking now to see if they have a melee weapon. So needs a seven. Does hit. And that will destroy an obstructor. Hits again.
Daniel says, well, that was insulting. My archers just stabbed you to death with swords.
Yep. He should have thrown him in there sooner. Oh, he just realized that the math didn't work. Second attack hits. Nope. So he only got one. Balance is restored to the universe. Balance is restored. See that pile of tokens over there. And that is the end of that. All right, so Watts in an okay position after that, though not great. Losing two inverters that turn certainly stings, although he's got an inverter that's left, fully healed, and he's got the Primaxium.
We've seen Watt in some pretty sticky situations before, and well, he gets second, so we'll see what happens this time.
I feel like this is Watt's dance. Time to break that. You're now Wild Dice Watt. Wild Dice Watt, not second place Jason. All right, see Jason considering what he's going to do here. Planning it out. I mean, you can't throw away the danger that Primaxium represents. It's huge. It hasn't been touched. It can pull guys out of directions. So we see three going on. It looks like the inverter, I think, is what he pointed to from Lucan. Positive charge also just such a great spell in terms of what it can do for the... So we see, yep, three going on the inverter. See the Enigma Foundry doing what it does, creating three new obstructors. And with those chain weapons on the charge against Griffins, they're going to be able to do a decent amount of work as well because they're bypassing that shield. So instead of being seven off, they're only going to be five off. So we see We see the Optifex Directive pulling a page out of the Stormfall book and charging. Hits Issian and doesn't do anything. And then we see another one miss. So trying to swing the wrenches, but not really doing a great job of it. Attunement Servitor now looks like it's going to activate. Shoot a big flare blob right at the objective. No problem. So that'll flare just about everything around it. So you got...
Watts is moving fast. It seems like he's got a real plan.
And these guys here. So a decent amount of stuff that is flared and minus two defense. Check the fire really quick. Fire doesn't go out and destroys an obstructor. So both Enigma Foundries were full at the time, so they cannot take souls at this point. So we see the Enigma Foundry, the other Enigma Foundry go, likely going to dump off a bunch more obstructors. Yep.
Bring a bunch more equaling one.
Well, it's back up to fighting strength, effectively. So we see the Angels charging, trying to put a little damage on some Griffins here. So Griffin has 360, which means they can basically charge behind the Griffin and not take free strikes. Birdseye having a little bit of a counterbalance there. Hits off six, so 1 point to the six. Any little bit helps at this point. Comes another Attunement Servitor, shooting a flare at the Banshee. Misses, 6 1-inch. That should still hit plenty of things. So all those models there are now flared. So basically all of the Myrmidons, the Murderdons.
How about Murdermadons?
Murdermadons?
Too many syllables.
Yeah, it's getting too much. It just sounds Dr. Seussy. So we see the obstructors going now and charging forward. Trying to just deal with those Griffins before we can see. Again, just having to deal with the synergy issue. Saw how effective it can be, even reduced by 4 Warjacks last turn.
Yeah, taking as many of those out as possible has got to be super high priority.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I think Watts has got a good chance of taking a couple of them out.
Mm-hmm.
But only time will tell.
But only time. Comes the last obstructor, looks like, going forward here. The problem, of course, so we see charging across the objective into the Griffin, not the objective itself. The problem, of course, still represents, I mean, it's still Imperatus. Imperatus, even without synergy up, can easily deal with an inverter with decent rolling and concentrated power. So we see a Stormfall Archer taking a free strike against an obstructor and failing to kill. The sword still being ineffectual. Quick check on a line of sight charge lane here for that obstructor over there. Trying to get into that damaged Griffin so he can remove it. And we see the charge to there. Looks like that's going to be just fine. Thanks to reach. So attacking the flared Griffin. Hits no problem. 3 dice, so... minus 5. That is a good roll.
Yes, it is.
Second guy hits no problem. Are we going to see a string of Michael Plummer rolling? Not as good. Still decent, though. Third guy on the Griffin hits no problem. 6 more. Whew. That's not bad for what you'd expect there.
It's the gift that keeps on Griffin.
Oh, but
we don't have Plumber here today.
It's true.
Got to keep up.
So we see another wrecked Griffin. Watt getting it done here. Plumber School of War Machine, high rolling. Wow. Plumber School War Machine, Jason Watt. Decided he was tired of being second place, Jason.
I'm just going to roll a bunch
and that, of... that just annihilated a Griffin again. Four more damage here on a more average style roll. 11 to hit. Another 10.
Man,
good
four fours,
Lord.
Five sixes everywhere.
Somebody check those dice. Jason just on a hot
hey,
streak
there's
here.
A one.
There we go. There's a lot of ones, actually. See another hit. All right, we're
swinging the other direction on that curve.
Yeah, we finally seem to have cooled down a little bit here. And misses on the Stormfall, of all the things. And that's the one he's sad about. All right, so two more Griffins down. Another Griffin really messed up. You just see all those black marks on Daniel's cards over there. So Daniel commenting that it's pretty hard for Watt to miss in general with the flares up. These entombment servitors paying for themselves, their whole cost of nothing. I suppose cost of Prime Axiom. See the inverter activate. He's going to charge a Griffin. Interesting. So we see a proxy base getting put in to show intended placement. Make sure that it's a legal move. Putting him right in front of Imperatus. Still enough on the table that this is a fairly aggressive move. Taking out a Griffin's one thing, but taking out Imperatus has to be at the top of Jason's mind at some point. So we see one go to the Prime Axiom. We see a charge attack. And finishes him off easily enough with the dice plus one hit from the Meteor Hammer. So one more wreck marker on the table. That center spot is just filled with rough terrain. Easy Rider going to become potentially critical here. So see a bond in the objective. Deals it four more points. Has three damage points left. Another buy on the objective. Destroys it. And the inverter gets set on fire from It Burns. Wait. Right. From that first attack that didn't destroy it. We see the Corollary advancing. Probably going to drop some focus on the Prime Axiom. So, gets one, inducts. Power transfer and induction one, and then keeps one on himself. So basically gives the Prime Axiom two overall. Now the Prime Axiom is sitting on three. Jason asking for confirmation of what Imperatus' power could wind up at, which is a respectable 23. Linissa's still around. The Arcanist's still around. Plenty of support pieces left in Daniel's army to make Imperatus or the Banshee just terrifying. Even to a Prime Axiom. Judge is just now confirming with the players what we just said ourselves.
Yep, Imperatus equals terrifying.
Imperatus equals terrifying. See a servitor coming out. So reflex servitor. So give Watt a so that it can charge the Stormfall and explode. Sacrificing that obstructor. He'll be back. So we see sell a spiker shot on the Banshee?
I believe.
Finally hits, being only rat 3 from Lucan. The cell spiker is less than optimal, but can do some damage. Forgot about Flare here, so does hit. Power 11. Not bad, but does no damage. So three focus down from Prime Axiom, really doing not a whole lot of work. Watt running out of things to use here. Lucan activates, runs over. Looks like he's going to go for that flag and try to win on CPs here. And then we've got the last group of OptiFX directives running forward. Just trying to get in the way. Although with sidestep on Imperatus, that's not as easy to get away with. And that will be the end of Jason's turn.
Back to Daniel. And Jason scores. Jason holds the zone for one control point and has destroyed the objective. So Jason is at two control points now. They are now trying to, they're basically discussing what to do with that reflex servitor. It looks like Jason forgot to activate it. The judge asked him to legally place it because it was laid over, but it doesn't look like Jason's going to activate that servitor because they had, it stopped time and officially passed the turn. And they're confirming that there's no rule that he has to activate all his models. That between turns discussion and cleanup of everything that's going on in games like this, things can get pretty complex. So everybody just wants to make sure that they're on the same page. We are here for those joining us at Gen Con 2015. We're in the event hall area. We've got lots of War Machine and Hordes going on, along with many other Privateer Press events, the Undercity and the like. We've had a great turnout here, a lot of great events, and everybody seems to be having a good time behind me. So far, so good. And we've got Daniel making some decisions, still has not allocated any focus yet.
Just got to watch the clock. They're at the point now where every second's going to count pretty significantly as well.
Yep, Watt's sitting at just about 8 minutes, right at 8 minutes more than Daniel.
See Watt doing a little balancing there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had a. He upkeeps synergy.
Yep, absolutely.
3 points to the Imperatus. Imperatus seems likely to make a run on that Prime Axiom.
Yeah, he's got a little bit of work to clear out there. And he really doesn't want to.
He doesn't want a free strike from
sacrifice.
That inverter.
No, not from the macro planner. That would end that run real quick. So, I think that inverter is in the way, though.
It's possibly worth it just to take that inverter out.
I mean, that's the easy move, but then Imperatus gets Prime Axiom to the face next turn. The problem is that you've got all of this rough terrain from all of these dead Myrmidons and inverters right in the center. And Imperatus, without Easy Rider, which is going to cost 3, which Byros doesn't have anymore, I don't think has the distance to get there.
So also means synergy goes away.
Uh-huh. Easy Rider's just a turn.
But it's a control, it's a self spell.
You can have one upkeep on yourself. So Easy Rider can be thrown up too, but it's a hefty spell at cost 3. So I think Imperatus is probably going to go after that inverter. Because he could try to... He could sidestep in. It's tough to tell without being able to measure exactly on the table just looking at the overhead, but he could use his charge if he can clear out the center and use sidestep to get one of these guys and sidestep in his 2 inches, which would be more than enough to take him in there.
So synergy up, 3 on the Banshee, 2 on Imperatus.
So the Banshee going to do some work as well. Curious to see exactly what that's going to be. So we see some quick discussion about flare and where it is at this point. We're trying to remove the flare tokens that Watt uses. Quick pause of the clock here. The clock restarts.
That flare is going to make it easier for Daniel to build up his first synergy because it's affecting that Optifex.
Mm-hmm. It's covered in Lumachem.
Did you just make that up, or is that really
what
it's
called? No, that's literally what it's called.
Ladies and gentlemen, David Carl.
Yeah. I think that, I don't know who actually made up the name. It might have been C-Cat. It glows.
All right, so Imperatus utilizes the Phoenix Field to heal back his shield.
Mm-hmm. Let's see, Daniel still deciding how he's going to allocate. Just burning time here. I mean, it's not... I get it. I get the concern.
That clock is ticking down, though.
He is just burning it away at this point. So, at this point, what do? You go after the inverter. You easily kill it with Imperatus. With the synergy bonus. But then the Prime Axiom can really go to town on Imperatus, and you lose that piece. So we looks like we're moving into the activation phase. So we have... So we have the Griffin now activating. Moving forward. So it's 3 on Banshee, 2 on Imperatus. Synergy upkept. So Griffin walks into the zone. Attacks on the Clockwork Angel. Needs a 6. Destroys it. Enigma Foundry gets that soul. Angel is down. Synergy goes up to +1. Second Halberd Strike goes on another Clockwork Angel. Hits. And that will eliminate that one. And that will put a soul on another Enigma Foundry. So that clears up Imperatus.
That frees up Imperatus.
At least to go after that Enigma Foundry. There's still plenty in the way for the Prime Askim run. So we see some free strikes happening here, it looks like. So we see aiming happening with 2 of them, and one guy turns in, attacks with a sword.
And he misses.
Hmm. So manages to kill the obstructor, and then we see a brutal damage shot into the Enigma Foundry with an aiming. Does hit. Dice minus six. It's going to do three. So that'll leave it with seven. Getting a little work done. It's going to be really critical for Daniel to remove those Enigma Foundries if he doesn't want to face never-ending waves of obstructors. And as we saw, the obstructors are pretty efficient against Griffins, for sure. Thanks to the chain weapon ability from their flails. Daniel. So we see a free strike getting made against the Fane Knight from the mechanic. And misses. Fane Knight.
Not terribly intimidated by that
no.
wrench attack.
A poor Optifex directive. He's not used to swinging things hard.
Look at me. Look at me.
See an attack on the Optifex. Hits and will kill. Getting rid of that attunement servitor. And destroys that guy. So, Issian moving two models, nothing of which seemed vitally important at this point. Manissa Rissel is going to run, trying to get in position for Hunter's Mark in a little bit. So, in the trench, pretty safe, in a good spot to Hunter's Mark, the Primaxium, if Imperators of the Banshee can survive Watt's next turn. The Stormfall Archers go next. So three of them aim, one advances and shoots. So it'll still clip with the deviation. It'll also still hit the Aspis. No damage to the Aspis.
Now we'll and take out that Optifex.
Kill the Optifex. So last guy passes his check. And it is worth noting that Jason's objective is Effigy of Valor, which provides fearless to models within 4 inches of it, or rallies fleeing models within 4 inches of it. But his Optifex are the only ones that are actually affected by morale of any type. Everyone else being a robot. Unfeeling and cold.
You know, this will allow Daniel to score a CP this turn if he can dominate that flag. But it's going to put Viros at a lot of risk.
Yeah, I doubt... I don't think Daniel's going to go for the flag.
The single point's probably not worth exposing Veros.
So, checking to see if that blast damage is going to hit Lanissa. It doesn't look like it's going to.
Ah, the 3 5-inches? That's bad news.
So, see. No.
Nah.
Nope. That was close, though. Definitely dusted her. So, a quick check on line of sight. Daniel quickly running out of time, though. He's down to 13:40 on the clock. He's going to have to start moving a little quicker here. He's taking attacks on things that I mean, it looks like that attunement servitor is still just in the zone, maybe. But that'll do nothing. Does clip an obstructor and manages to kill. So, decent blast damage roll. But Daniel can't... There's very little Daniel can do against that zone until he removes the objective and Enigma Foundry and the Prime Axiom and several obstructors. I don't see him going for the... See a focus going on the Aspis. So we see a charge going on from the Aspis. So he's going to lose quite a bit of distance from the wreckage. So it looks like he totally has distance to get in there. So taking a swing. So seven thanks to Synergy. Synergy's up by two.
He does beat back.
Yep. So take a second shot on that attunement servitor. Mm-hmm. So Synergy's now at two. He's not gonna be able to use Virus to bump it up again. Which means that at the moment he's looking at maybe plus three for his last activation. Still useful. So just checking to see which Arcanist needs to activate next. You see it advance. Really? So focus point goes on the Griffin. So, yep. So they just realized now that Griffin already advanced and activated. So. So, Synergy at plus two. Daniel realizing that's not a great spot to be. And power boost stays because that's what Daniel declared. So, that Griffin's just sitting on a useless focus point, forgetting about concentrate power. And Jason having him stick with that, not letting him take it back because he also took the same hit when he failed to countercharge with his reflex servitor.
That's right. As I heard Tim Bankey say, no take backs at the Iron Gauntlet.
Should just change that to no Tim Banksies.
Nope.
Sounds similar.
No Banksies.
No Banksies.
No take Banksies.
No take Banksies. All right. 14 points to the two. Wow. Good free strike. All right. See an attack on an obstructor from Imperatus. Sidesteps. So it's going to attack another obstructor. Not entirely sure. Is the Banshee going to go after the... So, sidesteps 1 inch because of the rough terrain. Swing on the obstructor. So, we see a quick confirmation on what's going on here. So we see a quick discussion here going on about melee distance here. Looks like Daniel's just trying to remove the obstructor unit completely so it can't be brought back by the Enigma Foundries, which is not a terrible strategy at this point. It makes those Enigma Foundries pretty well useless at that point.
Yeah, they need to stop that clock.
Yep. So they can still repair, which... You know, has valid use for keeping that Prime Axiom fighting. See the pause. I see some very careful measuring checks here going on. Watt finally understanding what's going on here. Thanks to Tim Bankey's
using a bottle cap for a diagram.
Yeah. Using those hot dice. So Watt apologizing for replacing the unit leader, which obviously altered a little bit of where that model was. Likely, though, at this point, they're just going to rule him in. Yep. It sounds like that's what's going to happen, so. So, yep. Because Jason moved the model before the measurement could be made, the judges are ruling that the original position puts it in Daniel's favor. So Imperius will take another swing. And then he's going to attack one more time on one more obstructor. And that will take care of two more. The obstructor's teleflail is making this a little more difficult than it should be.
Convergencing.
Convergencing, yes. Now we've got the Banshee with three focus deciding to just aim and boost a shot into the last, trying to eliminate that obstructor unit.
That obstructor's going to have cover there.
So that is going to hit barely, which will slam. And that will eliminate the last two obstructors. Oh, nope. So there's one anchor in the back. That's right. The guy's been hanging out in the backfield the whole time. He's now in formation. So that unit will be coming back. So Virus is making a run for the flag. You were right. See a pause here. Measuring from the back of the base. So he loses 10 inches. To get through the forest. It leaves him more than enough to get to the flag. All right. So going to dominate the flag to score one. So now we're going to have a flag off, it looks like.
Models can move through that flag, and yes, that includes being drugged through that flag.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Question is he within 16 of the Prime Axiom? And if he is, can you get rid of Scarathisian and Linus Arissal? Or so fire needs to happen first.
These guys are getting excited. Things are
getting very excited.
Getting tense into the end. It's hard to stay focused after a long day of gaming.
So you got a fire on the Invigorator. Does it. So we get three to the Invigorator.
Jason's got four times more time left on his
clock
than Daniel does.
That was a long turn Daniel took. And I don't know that he really netted anything out of it. So the reflex servitor hits, blows up his charge target, and the other Stormfall has exploded as well. So the POW 14 insta kills, and then the blast damage on an 11 definitely kills that. Last one passes his command check, though. He's sticking to the fight. The Optifact Directive running to get out of the way.
Contest
that
flag. Gonna
go contest. At least stall Daniel for a turn. At this point, it looks like Watt's just simply going to get Lucan on his flag, his chosen flag to dominate, and try to just win on CP since he's up by two.
Well, he can likely clear that zone, too.
Imperatus is definitely out there. You've got a lot of jacks left, though, and Imperatus is no soft target, considering that he'll come back to life from Phoenix Protocol. But Prime Axiom and Inverter definitely able to get that work done. Here comes some instructors. Yep. See the same thing happen with that other Enigma Foundry. So while that obstructor unit will be down, it's not going to be out by any means. Checking defense on Imperatus. So we're going to see a boost Mackerel Pummeler. And that'll hit no problem.
Yes, it will.
So dice plus two now on Imperatus. And that'll be 8 damage, which will burn through most of the field. That'll be 8 more points from the Meteor Hammer. So Imperatus has 6 boxes left after those 2 attacks. So we see an induction happening of a focus back to the Prime Axiom. 6 more points. We'll destroy it and activate Phoenix Protocol. So his field comes back to full. He gains 1 in each system. So puts him at 18 more to burn through, but he's still knocked down, which is kind of critical at this point. So we see a bind attack. So half dead again. And that'll end the inverter. So Corollary is going to activate. Going to get a focus point from being within Lucan's range. From Accumulator, advances forward. It's going to drop 2 probably on... Induct 1 to the Axiom and put 1 on the Axiom. Oh, so... So the Axiom is now sitting on 3. The Axiom's got some work to do. It's got to kill 3 jacks to clear out that zone. So we see a charge going on. So declare charge, Axiom charging Imperatus, going after Imperatus. So gonna see a proxy base come out here. As long as Watt can get in there, he shouldn't have a problem.
I don't see this not working.
The real question, of course, is will Jason's dice stick with him and allow him to hit those not knocked down lights? If he can hit that, he's going to go up to 4.
Auto hit on the Imperatus.
So, plus 2. That should do it.
We'll leave him with 1.
No. Yep, 1 left. So, second. Yep. Yeah, he got him.
It's a Griffin at dice plus 2.
And that'll be 8 points to the Griffin's 1.
Not sure how banged up these guys are.
Neither of them have taken a lot of damage. Just a little damage to the field. So 12 more to the 6. So the shield's now down on the Griffin. Buys an attack and wrecks him easy because of sustained attack making an auto hit and then the plus damage over arm just auto doing the death blow. And that's not going to get rid of the Aspis though.
Nope.
Although synergy is way down now. And then we see the obstructors coming right back. So that unit that was very nearly destroyed, almost back up to full strength, just 2 shy. 3 shy. 3 shy, excuse me. So here come the obstructors trying to get work done on the Aspis. Maybe get 3.
I think that Enigma Foundry's in the way.
Mm-hmm. Well, in the distance, too. They've... Yep. So they're just going to get into the zone and cause some problems. See a charge over there. Just get rid of that Stormfall Archer. Could swing it. Just making sure everyone's within 7 is the real trick here. And that shouldn't be a problem. There's the leader. So quick check on 7 is good. 7 on this side. So no problems there. It's the Stormfall, and that'll be a dead Stormfall.
All right. What's going to happen with this Aspis?
But only an Aspis remains. Hits. 8 damage. Not bad. Not enough, it looks like.
Yeah, it was an undamaged Aspis.
Just cracking through the field and doing 1 column's worth of damage. And we'll see Lucant go to the flag. And runs. And then the question is the Aspis in the zone? So the Aspis is out, which means that Jason Watt will win this with 5 points because there's nothing that Daniel can do to contest the flag on the other side. So Daniel will... concede the game there on points. So Jason Watt.
Jason, I won a final Watt.
Jason Watt wins the Gen Con 2015 IG qualifier final round by CPs in a closely contested and hotly matched game between Daniel Porter and his Retribution army. So from everyone here at the Privateer Press crew, along with all of our judges and fantastic volunteers, thanks for joining us for this fantastic finals match. We will see you again on the road for the next Iron Gauntlet final, live stream straight to your house from wherever we are. So thank you very much. For Privateer Press, I'm Will Schick.
And I'm Ed Bourelle.
And we'll see you on the next one.
Have a blast.